Back in the 1990s, because of course I have to bring up the 1990s, there was this critique of startup culture as underpants gnomes. The implication was that a lot of startups, were claiming that they knew where they were going, but they had no actual clue. Basically, it was step one, do a thing, collect underpants, whatever. Step two, ? Step three, profit. That struck home at the time. I was part of the Austin startup community, but I think it's actually more apt as an analogy for the current AI landscape. So we've been through at least two previous cycles of true AI is just around the corner in the last 50 or so years. And each time it's turned out we actually had no clue how to get from what we were working on to where we wanted to go. So we'll see what happens, but many people, including me, think that when it comes to general artificial intelligence, or AGI, we're still just as clueless as the underpants gnomes. The human brain, according to experts, is arguably the most complex system that humans are aware of. Now, not everybody believes this, but there are some links below. And it's without dispute, at least, that our current state-of-the-art LLMs are far, far, far simpler than what we know of the human brain, and we don't understand a lot of the human brain. And the human brain is the only thing we know that can generate human-level intelligence. So the idea that a really simple, relatively speaking, LLM will be able to create human-level intelligence, I'm kind of skeptical about that. And in addition, the human brain is able to incorporate feedback almost continuously, whereas LLMs, even the ones that can go and look at the internet at the moment, their networks are frozen at the time of training. Because of those two factors, at least, although there are a lot of others, a lot of people, including me, don't believe that LLMs are the last step on the way to human-level intelligence. But the last underpants gnome question eventually got answered, right? So a lot of startups failed in the late 90s and early 2000s. But what came out of that was e-commerce and internet-targeted advertising, which turned out to be useful, although like a lot of things, there have been some downsides. Like e-commerce, the LLMs we have now, despite some issues, are genuinely widely useful. And they have some really useful applications. So I think that for the current AI cycle, we might have a step two. Not for AGI, but when it comes to how we might be able to provide economic value and actually generate profits. And by we, I mean a lot of us, not just the OpenAIs and the Anthropics of the world. Although big companies like Amazon grabbed a huge share of e-commerce, a whole bunch of other companies benefited from the rise of that ecosystem too. But those two things are tied together. As long as we're listening to the hype and we believe that AGI is just around the corner and all of the jobs are about to go away and be replaced by AI, there's no incentive to try to apply any of this and there's no path to profit. In order for us to get to the part where we start using the current LLM technology to actually get stuff done, we have to give up on AGI and we have to get past the hype cycle. Because few people will invest in building something now if ChatGPT 5 or 6 is going to make it irrelevant in a year or two. And even if we did build something now that's useful, few businesses, if any, are going to be willing to try to adopt that thing if it turns out that ChatGPT 5 or 6 is likely to make that irrelevant in a year or two. So today, I'm going to try to make two cases. I'm going to try to make the case that it's time for software developers and software companies to both reject the AGI hype and start at least planning for a profitable phase two. The comments on this video are going to be This is the Internet of Bugs. My name is Carl. And I'm going to start today with an interview that Ezra Klein released with the CEO of Anthropic. I've put the link in the show notes, as always. The word exponential was mentioned unchallenged like 18 times. Now, I'm not an AI or an ML expert, but I do know software, and I know computational scaling, and my degree's in physics. Any experimental physicist or scientist can tell you that exponential growth doesn't actually happen. It doesn't exist in the real world. It's a theoretical mathematical construct, and it can't happen. The reason is, in the real world, there aren't infinite resources. Here, growth always has limitations. What we refer to as exponential is actually a particular part of what's called a logistic curve, where there are far more resources available than is needed to grow. Once those resources become constrained, the exponential part are going to stop. So here's a graph from 3Blue1Brown, which is a fantastic explainer of YouTube channel. Again, link to the full video below. This is the video that explains about logistic curves. We know that our current AI models can't grow forever because nothing can grow forever. We know they will run out of resources at some point. The thing is, we don't know what resource will run out of first. We won't know what the limiting factor is until we actually hit it. Now, it's possible we'll start running out of the critical resource very soon. It's possible we already have and just don't know it yet. It's actually possible that a few people know it, but they aren't admitting it to the public yet. There's an article that came out the day after the Ezra Klein interview was posted, detailing evidence that LLMs are already reaching a point of diminishing returns. We're throwing more and more resources at LLMs, but the benchmarks just aren't going up commensurately. That article linked to this paper from last month showing that since 2012, the median doubling time for effective compute is 8.4 months with a 95% confidence interval 4.5 to 14.3 months. This graph from that paper shows that basically every 8 months or so, models are getting roughly twice as efficient. Note, this graph is log scale, so a straight line down into the right indicates an exponential reduction. This is a graph I made of the same data. It's the same data as the previous graph, only I'm not using log scale. I'm using smaller dots so you can see better. And I put a trend curve in there that was just added by Apple's numbers spreadsheet. So answering a question in 2023 should have taken roughly half as many resources as it took to answer that same question in 2022. And roughly a 16th as many resources as 4 years earlier in 2019. But here's the graph from another resource. It shows that since mid-2019, improvements on the multitask language understanding benchmark have been linear, not exponential. So we decrease the amount of effort we're expending, and that decrease is exponential, but the benchmark improvement that we're getting for it is only linear. And that disconnect between the exponential and the linear suggests there might be some other factor that's limiting our efficiency. And we might actually know what it is. So Google did an experiment in 2022 with a model called Chinchilla. There's a paper presented at the World AI Alignment Forum that breaks down the implications of that. Chinchilla found there's a sweet spot between the amount of data a model is trained on, the number of tokens, and the number of parameters it has. It seems to show that past this optimal ratio, if you throw more compute at the same size data set, it just doesn't increase functionality, it just wastes resources. So if the Chinchilla paper is right, then the number of tokens is a limiting factor. And if that's true, how close are we to running out? Last month, the 2024 Stanford Annual AI Index report came out. There was a four-page special section called Will Models Run Out of Data? And it started on page 26. Of course, no mention of running out of data makes it to any of the key takeaways or summary or anything that you would know if you just read the first few pages. And I wonder why that is. Actually, I don't wonder why that is at all. That section references a paper from Epic AI that estimates we could run out of high-quality language stock in the next year, if we haven't already. In addition, there's a crisis of data quality. Several papers have shown an effect called model collapse, which happens when a model is trained on LLM-generated data. Over time, becomes like having a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy, if anybody on YouTube even knows what a photocopy is anymore. But it causes the data to become more and more and more similar, and all of the interesting stuff to go away. And eventually, it just kind of converges on boring. There's a graphic that kind of displays that. Now, we don't know for sure yet that the data problem is going to be the limiting factor, but evidence points to that, and we should find out before too long. Now, we're still going to get a GPT-5 one of these days, but if this evidence is correct, it's not going to be the dramatic increase that the hype has led many to believe. Closer to home, talking to the developers out there, the running out of data problem is even worse for code generation. If training data is the bottleneck, the improvements in code generation are going to slow down even more. Because there are orders of magnitude more English tokens available on the internet than there are available tokens from human written source code, right? And there's already evidence that code generation isn't all that it's claimed to be. So GitHub produced a study in 2022 that showed that programmers were 55% faster when they were using AI, which is cool. But with 2 more years of GitHub CoPilot data, a new paper shows that AI-generated code creates a downward pressure on code quality. That paper, which is from GitClear, shows that AI-generated code has a much higher likelihood of being reverted or rewritten within the first 2 weeks. It's a metric they call code churn. There are other quality metrics that are a problem, copy-paste, repeating, that kind of stuff, but the code churn one is really bad. So just a quick recap. We know that growth must be limited on something. The Chinchilla experiments imply that something might be data. High quality data is running out, or it has already. There's evidence that general LLM progress has dramatically slowed recently, increasing only linearly since 2020. Code generation has orders of magnitude less data that requires more correctness than English. And we're already seeing evidence of AI reducing general code quality. And if all that turns out to be correct, in many ways, that's really good for business, and it's good for us, the developers. So we've been living in a world where no one really wanted to invest in building software products around LLMs that would apply to business problems, because everybody believed that the LLMs would be twice as good next year, so they might be able to handle the business problem on their own, and you would have wasted your time and money. Once it becomes clear that the growth is becoming just incremental, then it will be time to apply LLMs to real-world problems, and that means writing software to interface between the LLMs and the business issues. Based on the code quality data from GitClear, we're still going to need plenty of programmers. Those programmers might be able to create code a little faster with AI, but since the AI-generated code seems to require a lot of rework, it might be fine for one-shot, let's get the answer and throw the code away problems, but not for code that needs to be maintained long-term. So I'm guessing the next few years, maybe 3 to 5, there are going to be a lot of people that are going to be taking the LLM models, and they're going to be wrapping non-AI functionality around them to specialize them for specific use cases. This is going to be a thing kind of the way Devin, or at least the open source versions like Devika and OpenDevin that work about as well as Devin, but we can actually look under the hood and see how they work. Those systems are an LLM, but with a browser module plugged in and a terminal module and a planning module and a reporting module and some expert systems around it that kind of tell it what to do. That kind of system can be applied not just to, you know, let's pretend to be an AI engineer, but it can also be applied to all kinds of business problems. The same way that 2008 to 2012 or 2014, something in there, was a lot about taking existing stuff like websites and then converting them to become mobile apps. 2024 to 2027 or 2029, something like that, might be taking a lot of existing things, services, software, apps, websites, that kind of thing, and reforming them around the capabilities of LLMs. It feels to me now a lot like 2008. The first Apple App Store had just been announced, and we thought we could make money from it, but we weren't quite sure. And the economy was kind of illiquid because the mortgage bubble had just popped and we were in the beginnings of the Great Recession. At the moment, it seems like generative AI is going to be a money maker, but we're not quite sure, and the economy is kind of illiquid because interest rates are still really high. If when that settles, we could just well be off to the races. Am I right? No idea. But we should know soon. We've heard a lot recently about how ChatGPT-5 is supposed to be a huge leap, and it's supposed to be released as early as this summer. There's a link to that in the notes below. If we don't get an exponentially better ChatGPT-5 this year, then hopefully people will start recognizing that it's time to change from let's wait for better LLMs to let's take the current LLMs and let's start applying it to real-world problems. And if we can do that, that will be a phase two that we can live with. Remember, the internet is full of bugs. Anyone who tells different is probably trying to sell you some stupid AI service. Let's be careful out there.